right. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. This is David Patrick Carey with Church of the Eternal Logos. And tonight, I want to talk to you guys about the Transcendent Theology of Orthodox Mysticism. And so a couple streams ago, I did a stream on the Mysterium Tremendum. We talked about Rudolf Otto. We talked about William James. We talked about how the academy or the field of religious studies goes about studying religious mysticism. And we talked sort of a heady talk about mysticism, generally speaking, across all the different world religions. However, tonight we're going to be focusing on Orthodox mysticism. And then I'm no expert on these topics, so this is more of an introduction to Orthodox mysticism, but I think there's a lot to be said and a lot of interesting insights. One of which, I think if we look at, I believe Orthodox mysticism in a way encapsulates all these other forms of mysticism we might see. For example, mystical union, whether it be the yogic practices, those are obviously physical prostrations, different postures, but many of the world religions talk about mystical union. Well, obviously, we're going to have mystical union in Orthodoxy. Well, you know, psychedelics and some of the shamanic traditions talk about mystical sacraments, you know, inebriating substance or things that you have to intake to become one with God. Well, Orthodoxy has the mystical sacrament of the Eucharist. Well, what about the unknowability? You know, I really like Plotinus and Proclus and some of the Neoplatonic traditions because their mysticism maintains God's own unknowability. Well, we have that with St. Dionysius, and we're going to read a little bit of the mystical theology that in Orthodoxy, God is both knowable and unknowable. And so we're going to talk about the energy-essence distinction and how this is a sort of mystical theology that allows God to be absolutely immanent. I can encounter and interact with God directly, but at the same time, God is beyond categorization. And last video, we talked about God, one of the forms of mysticism. There's a few different definitions of mysticism, that there's union with the divine. Well, we're going to find that in our descriptions of that hesychastic tradition and the hesychasm, generally speaking. We're going to find the intuitive insight. This was another definition of what mysticism is. And we're going to see this with our theology of the nous, our sort of noetic capabilities of the eye of the heart or the eye of the soul, the sort of singular eye that, of course, Orthodoxy understands Scripture and Christ to be talking about. Not the pineal gland, not the third eye, not the crown chakra, not a sort of apotheotic tradition. Apotheosis, the idea that you are God, and that in many of these other forms of mysticism, whether it be shamanic or Hindu or Buddhist or all these other forms of mysticism, it's sort of an eradication, a destruction, an annihilation of one's individuality, one's personhood, as we understand that in the theological context. And instead, it's a union with the divine in regards to this absolute oneness. Well, in our theology, we're going to see that we maintain this specificity of our personhood while also becoming God through a process of theosis. So it's not apotheosis. It's not that you are the sort of particular form of God that really has to realize that he's just a temporal representation within this eternal, abstract, ethereal oneness. No, God is oneness in essence, and God is eternal and transcendent. But at the same time, God is three persons. You and I are persons. And when we become gods by grace, we're also going to maintain our personhood. This maintaining of one's specificity or the personhood is actually going to differentiate Orthodox mysticism from all these other forms of mysticism. If you start looking at ancient forms of mystical practices or entheogenic or psychedelic sacraments, you're going to see that almost all these theologies believe that one has to annihilate their personhood to realize their divinity. This is the exact opposite in Orthodoxy. One has to maintain their personhood. One has to take control and discipline themselves over their unique substantiation in time to then become one with God, because God himself is three persons. And so we're going to see union with divine, the intuitive insight. This is another form of mystical knowledge or mystical knowing. We're going to find this in Orthodoxy, but we're also going to find the transcending of rational categories, which is another definition of what mysticism is if you look at our previous video or my previous video on the Mysterium Tremendum. So the apophatic emphasis of Orthodox theology is going to maintain that unknowability of God. This is mystical. And again, we're going to read this in the mystical theology of St. Dionysius the Areopagite. And all this leads to what Bernard McGinn, as I said, one of the more popular scholars of Christian mysticism in the academic field, talks about how Christian mysticism is really interested in the transformation of the person, the transformation of the human. And we're also going to find this in Orthodoxy because that's the point of theosis itself. And so God being totally transcendent and yet immanent at the same time is going to be essential as we get into the energy essence distinction. And of course, we're going to have to remember St. Gregory Palamas and his debates with Bar-Lam and how Bar-Lam, representing that really sort of Western bent of Western theology, where it's much more rationalistic, it's much more intellectual. And we see with Gregory Palamas, we see with St. Simeon the New Theologian, the return back to a more mystical understanding. And so you don't have to go far from Vladimir Lasky's The Mystical Theology of the Eastern Church. The entire structure of Orthodoxy is mystical. The entire structure of Orthodoxy is non-dialectical. And so you look at many of these rationalistic enlightenment categories of religion, you're going to see the profane on one hand and sacred on the other. Again, a dialectic. But we don't see this in Orthodoxy because Christ in his baptism deifies all of creation. We, you and I, being mankind, are the epitome. We are the priest of creation. And so we are that bridge point between created and the uncreated. We're made in the image of the uncreated, but you and I are created. And so this profane versus sacred, this dichotomy really doesn't work in Orthodoxy. And that's why, unlike our Western brothers and sisters in Catholicism or Protestantism, Orthodoxy is a lifestyle. Orthodoxy is way more than just, well, here I'm a Christian, and then here is like my regular day, everyday life. No, it all goes together. There is no splitting. Because again, Orthodox theology is absolutely mystical. If mysticism is about unity, then our theology and the collapsing of these dialectical categories throughout the Greek philosophical tradition, throughout rationalistic enlightenment processes, we are mystical in every aspect. Through our sacraments, through our theology, through our unknowability of God's essence, through our direct encountering with God's energies, through our tradition of hesychasm, all of it is mystical. And so the deeper you get into Orthodox mysticism, the more you see that it's an endless well, but it's unique. It is unique. And so we're not perennialists. Orthodox mysticism doesn't fit nicely within a perennialistic box that some secular people would like to look at. It's more than that. Not that people don't try to. Of course they do, to try to fit hesychasm. I saw one video in preparation for today's stream trying to equate Orthodox hesychistic activity with Hindu yoga. It's not the same. It's not the same at all. And the theology of the energies, the theology of the personhood, these are going to be essential differentiating marks of our tradition versus theirs. And so we have the mystical union, the mystical sacraments, the mystical unknowability, mystical devotion, mystical prayer, mystical asceticism, and also mystical knowledge. All of this fits within the category of Orthodox mysticism, of which I would say all mystical practices worldwide are just prefigurings of the full revelation, the full truth of what Orthodoxy is. And Orthodox mysticism being the encapsulation of all mystical practices around the world. Except the difference is our mysticism takes you towards God as three persons, encountering God on a personal level. and this is going to be, and you've heard me talk about this over and over and over again, is how do we understand this theology of personhood? Well, how do you know me and I know you? How do you know anybody in the world? You know people through personal encounters, through their energies, through the things I've said, the videos I've created, the streams I've done. Everything that I do is an energetic activity. And this is how my personhood is understood and known by you as a person. And this is how we're going to understand who God is. And we do this through an energetic process of His uncreated energies. And so we directly encounter God at an immanent level. And yet at the same time, it's completely transcendent and unknowable. And so we hold both those together. There's not a tension. We're not Platonists, where we have to get out of our body. We're not going to astral project. We're not going to be some ethereal spirit because the body is gross and bad. It all goes together. It all goes together. We collapse these dialectics. We're going to take our bodies with us into the transcendent kingdom. So this is the kind of stuff we're going to be getting into today, as well as what is hesychasm? Contemplative prayer, experiential knowledge of God. We're going to talk a little bit about hesychasm. I got a few videos that we're going to look at, one by Father Spirit and Bailey, two by two other Orthodox clergy talking, one about hesychasm, one about what mysticism is. And then we're going to get into, and I'm going to read the Ortho Wiki. If you guys didn't know, there is an Orthodox Wiki out there. Check out Ortho Wiki if you didn't know. But we're going to look at catharsis, the purification process, that part of the hesychastic tradition. Yes, it's much more ascetical, and so, but you don't have to be an ascetic. You don't have to be a monk with an orthodoxy to get to the kingdom. You don't have to be a monk to be deified. There's different paths. So even the archetype of perennialism, this idea that there's multiple paths to get the same mountaintop, only in orthodoxy is that true. The lay life, the clerical life, the monastic life, these are different paths to the top of the mountaintop, which is essentially deification, becoming what God is by nature. We become by grace, and grace is a gift. You and I can't earn it. You and I didn't deserve to be created. Adam and Eve didn't deserve it. We didn't deserve Christ's incarnation. We don't deserve theosis. We don't deserve the blessings we receive. And that's why we give thanks. Because when you get a gift from somebody, you say thank you, correct? And that's what the Eucharist is, Eucharista, thanksgiving. We go and we celebrate God and we give thanks to God for all things because everything we receive is a gift. And this is a mystical process in and of itself. So this is what we're going to get into today. Before we dive into some of the videos and articles I want to get into, I want to say if you like what we're doing or what I'm doing here at Church of the Eternal Logos and you'd like to support, please become a website member. I have not done it yet. I said I was going to. I have not done it yet. I was going to post a video talking about the time that I got arrested. Yes, there was a time once long ago that I actually was arrested, went to jail. And I want to share that story with you guys, but it's only going to be for members. So behind the paywall over at the website, if you like what I'm doing, it's a $5 a month membership. It's a great way to try to support me. I really appreciate it. In exchange, I can give you guys exclusive video content. And I'm going to, the second half of the mysticism stream is actually already up there. I think there's 30 some videos already in that video library. And probably tomorrow night, because I'm very busy with school stuff, I will be recording and posting the story about me getting arrested and going to jail. When was it? Well, you have to find out. And if that's something you'd like to hear, I have a lot of anecdotal stories on there, and I'm going to share a few more over at the website. One, you know, at the website, I have one on my ayahuasca journey. I have one talking about getting in a fight in China. That's a pretty wild story. So again, all that stuff is up over at the website for members only. If that's something you'd be interested in, I know not everybody would be, but this is a great way to try to help me and build Church of the Eternal Logos. Also, if you guys would like to set up a one-on-one session, you want to talk about theology or philosophy or world religions or any other thing, you can do so using the link that I just posted, signing up for one-on-ones. That is another great way to support the channel. Or you can also go to the shop. Go to the shop over at my website, davidpatrickcarey.com/shop. And purchase a hat, purchase a shirt, purchase some type of merchandise. That's another great way to try to help me out and support what we're doing here. So, with that being said, where do we want to get into? So, here's some of the stuff I want to share with you guys. Obviously, if you want to hear a further discussion on this book, The Mystical Theology of the Eastern Church, I actually did a stream with Jay Dyer. So, over on Dyer's channel, we did a two-part conversation. The first half is on his channel. The second half is behind his paywall. So go over to Dyer's channel and also become a member for his stuff. I know he's got a much larger video library and great, great stuff behind his paywall. But I also want to share with you guys three important figures in the discussion of Orthodox mysticism. One, of course, is Saint Gregory Palamas. Why is Palamas important? Well, as we see, we're going to get into it in today's stream. The energy essence distinction is essential. It's essential for how we understand what Orthodox mysticism is, and it's essential characteristic that differentiates Orthodoxy from all the other world religions, from all the other mystical practices around the world. That the energy essence distinction maintains God's transcendence, yet his immanent knowability, his immanent encounter, that through the energy essence distinction, you and I can actually engage with God. It's not just an analogy. And some of you, again, go listen to Dyer. He does great stuff regarding Catholic theology and the analogia, the analogy. And how in Catholicism, often you don't interact with God directly. You interact with an analogy of God. But that's not how we understand this as Orthodox. As Orthodox, just as you encounter me through the energetic processes I do, the words I speak, the streams I create, this all takes energy. And through these energetic processes, you come to know who David Patrick Harry is. Well, through the energy of love, which is an activity. Notice all the energies of God take action. They're not static. Love, truth, logic, reason, honor, glory, mercy, compassion. These things take action to do. It's not a passive activity, but as we engage with these energies, we can be synergized with God's energies and become more like God. This is the basis of Orthodox mysticism. Whether you're a hesychistic monk, whether you're a lay family man with kids and a wife, the way we become gods by grace is through God's energies. And you and I didn't deserve this. And yet it's still here for us because our God loves mankind. He's a good God. And because of his mercy and his infinite compassion, because all these energies, think about it, all these energies that we engage with, these uncreated energies, God is that in its infinity. He's infinitely merciful. He's infinitely knowledgeable. He's infinitely logical. He's infinitely compassionate. He's infinitely loving. So we, especially by being Orthodox Christians, are privileged, absolutely privileged, to know the unknowable, to experience the transcendent, that his essence remains apophatically unknowable, of which we're going to discuss when we read a little bit of Saint Dionysius here. Now, of course, for all the secular people, it's pseudo-Dionysius as Orthodox, and shout out to Jay Dyer. He sent me a very interesting article in regards to the Orthodox take that pseudo-Dionysius is actually Dionysius of Acts, and that it's not pseudo, but he is the real Dionysius. The whole debate, and I've mentioned this in previous streams, the whole debate on why Dionysius is pseudo is the dating of his writings often towards the 6th century, the 500s, that people say, oh, clearly this guy, whoever wrote these works, had read Plotinus and Proclus and Iamblichus and the Neoplatonists, and therefore we have to date him back here. However, the Orthodox take that I saw due to an article that Dyer shared with me is that actually this is the real Dionysius of the book of Acts that was converted by Paul when he's speaking about the unknown God, and that it is here that St. Dionysius actually writes his apophatic mystical theology of the Godhead, of which the Neoplatonists read him, and they develop their Neoplatonic doctrine. So this is a debated, contentious topic, but for anybody who doesn't know why I'm going to continue to refer to him as St. Dionysius, is that it's within the secular sphere that he's pseudo-Dionysius, just FYI. But I wanted to get into his very, very famous mystical theology, the mystical theology. And it's not very long at all. I may read the whole thing here. It's only, let's see, one, two, three, four, five, six, seven pages. I'll probably just read the whole thing today. I'll probably just read the whole mystical theology of St. Dionysius here. And I also have some beautiful stuff from St. Simeon, the new theologian. Now, why is St. Simeon important? Because of the hesychastic tradition. Because as people were wanting to move orthodoxy into a rationalistic intellectual sphere, it is our beloved saint, St. Simeon, the new theologian, who brings it back, brings orthodoxy back to its mystical dimension of an experience. It's an experience of God. That's the whole basis of our faith. And how do we experience God? It's not just the energies. It's the Eucharist. That we, in a mystery, eat that which we are. We encounter Christ in the Eucharist, Christ our God. This is where I think, again, all the sacramental, the psychedelic, the entheogenic, what does entheogenic mean? Entheogen is just a term that has been developed by scholars who study the sort of psychedelic phenomenon for the God within, that psychedelics reveal the God within. Well, within the Eucharist, that's exactly what we are doing, except it's not an inebriating process. We do it and as sober-mindedly. But I would argue, the more I study the Orthodox mystical categories, is that it encapsulates all forms of mysticism, and that wherever there's been these mystical sacraments, these are just prefigurings for what the Eucharist actually is. And the Eucharist really is the ultimate entheogen. It's the ultimate realization of God within. Because God became man, so you and I as men can become God. And that's the whole basis of Orthodox mysticism. But how does that process take place? We don't have to do our downward dog. We don't have to do our sun salutation. We don't have to sit in Zen gardens and meditate for hours on end. We don't have to blast our minds with DMT and ayahuasca for this process. We have to engage with the energies. We have to become part of the body of Christ. And that is belonging to an Orthodox parish, becoming an Orthodox member of a church. That's how you and I are the body of Christ. And in a mystery, as Christ's body ascended into the kingdom, ascended into the heavens, you and I, at the same time, are now the body of Christ here. But at the same time, you and I eat the body and blood of Christ. So we can then follow Christ into the kingdom. This is a mystical process. We are what we eat. And that the full revelation, as I said, of edible sacraments is the Eucharist. Now, both the apophatic unknowability and the direct union of God, that seems counterintuitive. How is God totally unknowable and yet also very knowable, and I can experience him on a personal level? How is God knowable on a personal level and then at the same time totally unknowable? That's mystical, and that's part of our Orthodox mysticism. And that both of these, the unknowability of God, makes sure that you and I don't think for a second that you and I can grasp God. We can't. God cannot be fit into a box. But at the same time, through grace, God allows himself to be presented through boxes, if you will, that you and I can understand. And so the personal, the mystical personal transformation of you, me, and all of us happens through an unknowable apophatic God that also makes himself incredibly knowable and imminent. But again, you and I didn't deserve this. You and I didn't do anything to earn this. It only comes to us because God loves humanity. Our God loves us, and he wants us to choose him through our free will, because you and I are made in the image of that which transcends. You and I are a physical icon, if you will, of the ultimate icon of Christ. And that our God, one of the beautiful things about our theology is the collapsing of the dialectics. Again, I was talking about the sacred and the profane, this type of dialectical tension. You see the Platonists, and you'll see this in Gnosticism. Gnosticism is a radical form of dualism, same thing with Manichaeanism. But you see it in the New Age to a degree, that there's always these dialectical tensions. One of them is that you, who you think you are, your person, is actually an illusion. Who you really are is God the Transcendent. God the Transcendent. But this is some ethereal abstract category. Well, our God is both. Our God is man and he's God. Our God is eternal and he's temporal. Our God is the King of Kings, and yet he's the most humble of beings. Our God is omniscient and self-limiting through a process of kenosis. Our God is knowable and unknowable. Our God continually collapses these dialectics. As the Platonists think the body is ooey-gooey gross, and that anything that's spiritually divine, anything that's spiritually proper, must be non-physical. Therefore, this relates to this idea of getting back to the oneness. This relates then to the divine consciousness, the cosmic Christ concepts, because whatever must be ultimately holy must not be physical. That is a dialectical tension that orthodoxy doesn't hold. God can be ultimately transcendent, non-physical, and he can also be physical. Why do we put these limitations on the divine? Orthodoxy doesn't do that, because orthodoxy offers us a full mystical theology. A theology that you're not going to find in any other world religion. You can't find this collapsing of dialectical tensions. Everybody wants to talk about the supremacy of oneness. Right now I'm working on an academic paper trying to talk about psychedelics as a new religious movement, and what is their worldview, what is their spirituality, and whether it's Western esoteric magic, whether it's Eastern mysticism, whether it's, you know, forms of pagan thought, it's always this privileging of oneness, that multiplicity must how be lesser. Multiplicity must be lesser to so many different worldviews. But why? Why is that the case? Well, if God is God and God is divine, then God is one, and we need to get back to the one. But our God is one in essence and three persons. So our God, the Godhead itself, is singular and multiple. Where are you going to, you can't find that in any other world religion. It's not in Islam. It's not in the Talmud. It's not in Hinduism. Only Brahma. The Brahma is the ultimate. You have the Atman and the Brahman in Hinduism. You may, and that's even debated in the different schools. Is your Atman a sort of smaller substantiation of the Brahman? What about the Nirvana? What about the nothingness of the various schools of Buddhism, which gets complicated, because as soon as you get into Vajrayana Buddhism and in the Tibetan sphere, now you have all these deities. So Buddhism is a very complicated thing to get at. But our God is one and three. So the fact that the Orthodox theology is continually, time and time and time again, is always collapsing dialectics, shows you that this is true unity. True unity is both one and two. True unity is both man and God. True unity is the fact that our God is the source of life, and yet somehow he died in a mystery to destroy death. Yes, our God is the source of life. Our God is eternal and chose to become a man in temporal time to also die and defeat death. Our God killed death. What the heck? That is mysticism. That's beyond rational categories. That's beyond dialectical tensions. And only Christian orthodoxy can give you this. And so again, we should celebrate the beautiful, beautiful gift we have in the Orthodox theology, in the Orthodox Church, of which, again, none of us deserved. None of us deserved, and yet here it is, and we have it. And that you and I can be gods by grace. So the first thing I want to get into is a few little videos. And I got tons of reading. I got so much reading, I don't even know what all I'm going to read. First thing I want to show you is, here's a great video by Father Spirit and Bailey that I want to show about the direct knowledge of God. He's going to talk about St. Gregory Palamas. St. Gregory Palamas. As I told you, we have our God exists in a mystery. Our God, as we would say, more so than the rationalistic processes of Protestantism, more so than even the scholastic tradition of Catholicism, we maintain the apophatic unknowability of our Godhead, but at the same time, we claim that we can directly encounter and engage and know God. How can we have direct knowledge of a God that's totally unknowable? Well, let's listen.
The tradition of the church has always been that God is directly knowable. Of course, God is ultimately unknowable. He is beyond the kind of knowing that we have of the things of this world. And the infinite God is a mystery. And even in all eternity, no one will know God fully. There is always more of God to learn and know and grow closer to. But despite this, the church has always taught that God does reveal himself to the human heart directly. We see in the Old Testament, through the prophets, we see the incarnation of his Son, Christ. We see the outpouring of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost and the life of the church. God chooses to reveal himself directly to the human heart. And this is defended by such writers as the three holy hierarchs, St. John Chrysostom, St. Gregory, St. Basil, St. Simeon the New Theologian. Throughout its history, church fathers have defended this truth that God is ultimately knowable directly. Now, in the West, a more scholastic, dare I say, legalistic tradition developed, and the likes of Thomas Aquinas said, well, since God is unmovable, unchanging, when people encounter him, it must be something else. It must be something created. And the church fathers said no. The apostles, for example, when they witnessed the transfiguration, they saw the very uncreated light of God directly. Now, this tradition was brought together and defended by a man called Gregory, St. Gregory of Palamas. And St. Gregory of Palamas was born in 1296. He was well educated, but when his father died, when he was around 20 years old, he entered Mount Athos, along with his brothers, and his mother and his sisters entered different monasteries. And at first, he lived in major monasteries, and then he moved to a skete, and he was taught the way of silence, Hesychia, inner silence, the life of the Hesychast. And for 20 years, he lived on Mount Athos, in simplicity. His life, the tradition says, consisted of 5 days of silence each week, inwardly praying to Christ, Lord Jesus Christ, illuminate my darkness. Now, the Hesychastic tradition spread, word of it spread, and Rome decided to try and refute this teaching. It sent Balaam to Mount Athos to argue against the Holy Fathers. And St. Gregory was brought by God to denounce the teachings of the West, to proclaim the truth of Orthodoxy, that God is knowable in himself, that it isn't something created simply to draw us closer to God that we know, but it is God that reveals himself to the heart directly, beyond words, beyond images, the direct experience of God that we are created for. So we today should take a number of things from St. Gregory, who the church has decided to commemorate on the second Sunday of Lent. He's that important to us. The first thing we should notice is this life of silence. We all need to find space, create space in our lives for silence. Here I am amongst the trees, and yet the noise of the cars is still encroaching, and I can still carry the worldly concerns that fill my heart. But we need to let go of these worldly noises. Create an inner peace, an inner silence. The church fathers say there are different kinds of silence. There is the silence of a beautiful woodland or a garden or a mountain. But we can still have the noise of the world in our hearts. But similarly, we can be walking through the streets of London or Athens and have an inner peace, an inner silence. So it is this inner peace, this inner silence we need to cultivate, allow to grow within us, make the space in order for us to meet with God. And this is what the whole of the tradition of the church is about, the disciplines of the church, the cycles of prayer and worship. It's all about drawing us closer to this direct experience of God. And this really is the second and most important thing we should take from St. Gregory Palamas. We are created not just to think about God, not to dwell on words about God or images of God, but beyond these things. Our hearts are created to be in communion with God Himself, the uncreated experience of God, God directly. But this can only ever happen to us when we strip away those barriers, those walls that we've encased our hearts. That we build these barriers around our hearts full of concerns and worldly troubles and pursuits and passions and sin. Our life must be dedicated to freeing ourselves, finding liberation from the enslavement that we've given ourselves to. And God promises us that He will pour Himself out to us. He will give of Himself, that we can find direct experience with the living God.
The grace of the Spirit takes possession of the quiet soul and gives it a taste of the unspeakable good things to come. Not just priests and monks, but every Christian without exception ought to dwell always in prayer. And this is St. Gregory Palamas. Again, one of my favorite church fathers. I highly recommend anybody reading. I'm not going to be reading Palamas today. I wanted to focus on St. Simeon the New Theologian and St. Dionysius the Areopagite in regards to our conversation on mysticism today. So I'm not going to be reading, but I do recommend, this is a great book. If you haven't read the Triads, get it. Palamas, St. John of Damascus, and St. Maximus the Confessor. Those are probably three of my favorite church fathers. Now, I'm also a big fan of St. John Chrysostom. I also like St. Basil and St. But St. Maximus is personally my favorite. But I really love reading Palamas. I really love reading St. John of Damascus. The intellectual sophistication and articulation. This is totally a side note, but guys, if you haven't bought this book, The Fountain of Knowledge, this book right here, get this one, right? This, because if you just buy The Fountain of Knowledge, that's just one book of St. John of Damascus. But this particular book has four books of his. The Fountain of Knowledge, the philosophical chapters on heresies and on the Orthodox faith. I should definitely do a stream just on St. John of Damascus. One of my absolute favorites. But I want to speak to you guys. Obviously, I have the mystical theology here of St. Dionysius, which is very apophatic. And I think maybe I should close with reading the apophatic Theology of Saint Dionysius the Areopagite. But one of the things is, I you know, how many of you guys have read Saint Simeon the New Theologian? As I said in previous streams, there's only three gentlemen who have the privilege of being of receiving the title of theologian in the Orthodox Church. There's, of course, my favorite right here, this icon right here, Saint John the theologian, Saint John the apostle, the beloved disciple, the author of the Gospel of John and the three epistles of John and the book of Revelation. Then you have Saint Gregory of Nazianzus, or Saint Gregory the theologian. He is the second gentleman who receives this very prestigious title, and of course only the third and the last at this point, and I assume will probably be the last, is Saint Simeon the New Theologian. And he's the new theologian, but he has an ancient truth. And this is what he was doing, was bringing the faith back to its ancient mystical traditions. And so what I want to read a few excerpts from the discourses of Saint Simeon the New Theologian. There's a section in here titled... let me show you. If you have this book, some of you may already have it. The Mystical Experience of Grace. The Mystical Experience of Grace in the Form of Thanksgiving. Now, I told you, part of this mystery, part of this mystical dimension of our Orthodox theology has to realize it's all about grace. It's all about grace. And what is grace? Well, according, shout out to my godfather, Subdeacon Mark, shout out to you. He has a definition that grace is the direct loving encounter of the living God. Grace is a direct loving. So if grace is a direct loving encounter of the living God, then grace is mystical in the context of Orthodox theology. It's a direct encounter with that which transcends all categories, that which is the source of divinity. That is the definition of mysticism. If you look just in secular definitions, academic understandings, and so that's what we do in the Eucharist. That's what we do in the Divine Liturgy. We're literally giving thanks. We're giving thanks. And so I have a few sections here in the Mystical Experience of Grace in the Forms of Thanksgiving. The first one is section 7, and then I'm going to read really the rest of it. Now, Saint Simeon the New Theologian was really, he developed the tradition of the Hesychasts, the Hesychism, which, again, I was talking about the catharsis. It's about purification. It's about an experiential knowledge of God. Through catharsis, one purifies themselves. Through theoria, one illuminates themselves. And through the process of theosis, one deifies themselves, all through grace. The whole process is through the process of grace. The difference in our Orthodox mysticism than, say, ayahuasca or some of these other psychedelics, we'll just use psychedelics or yoga, for example, is that there's a theology of works, if you will, in some of these other forms where you just have to do certain activities. You just have to do certain things, and then you get XYZ. You just do you do ABC, and then you get XYZ. Not in Orthodoxy. In Orthodoxy, you could do XYZ and never get the other things, because it's only by God's grace. God is in control of this process. You have no control. You can only humbly submit yourself to the process of theosis. And this happens in a multitude of ways. And so I want to highlight here, and we can learn a little bit more about Saint Simeon if you like, but I love, you're going to hear his mysticism. The first section I want to read is for strength and temptation. He's going to talk about a night in which he is awoken by polluted thoughts, by passions, probably sexual desires, probably erotic fantasies, maybe thoughts of money and lusts. Maybe it's greed. Maybe it's gluttony. But he says he's woken up by his passionate, temptuous thoughts, and then he resists. He fights through his own will. And then the next day, he's marveled that he was able to resist all this stuff. But then when he really sat and thought about it, it was Christ within himself that did it. And this is a mystery. And this is mysticism, that God was in the person. And this is true for you and me and anybody else. This is the gift of the Spirit and baptism, chrismation, becoming part of the body of Christ, in which we eat the body and blood of Christ to participate in the mystery of Jesus Christ, all through grace. And so here, check this section out. This is for strength in temptation. And you'll see this is absolutely mystical because it's about a realization of God within oneself. And hesychism is about silence. It's about silencing the world around you so you can go deeper and deeper and deeper inside oneself. You want to look at Zen. You want to look at Theravada, Mahayana, Vajrayana Buddhism, Pure Land, Chan, Shingon, Zen, whatever it is. You like Buddhism. Oh, maybe I like the... All these different mystical practices are somehow bringing one's attention inside usually. Now, obviously, the psychedelics kind of put an emphasis on exterior things. But in the hesychastic tradition, it's about silence, 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 and how God, when he actually presents himself, often presents himself as a body of light. And we can read this in the scripture. What happens on Mount Tabor? What happens at the Transfiguration? When God reveals, when Jesus Christ reveals his divinity, he reveals his uncreated light. And this is what the hesychasts are after. The hesychasts are after deep, deep internal investigation, silence, and interior journeying until one meets Christ within himself. That's the point of it. That, by definition, is mystical. So here we read section 7 in the discourses on the mystical... I told you guys in a second. The mystical experience of grace in the form of thanksgiving. Section 7. Then, as I reflected on the meaning of the vision, something yet more extraordinary than all this took place. While I was being tempted by evil demons in my sleep and being drawn by the machination to a passion of pollution, I resisted mightily and called on thee, the Lord of light, for help. So I awakened and escaped without harm from the hands of the tempters. I was amazed at myself, how I had shown firmness and courage. And even more than that, I had not been moved toward passion. And then I thought, quote, how did this unaccustomed triumph happen, that I should resist even while asleep and prevail over my adversaries and enemies and win an unexpected mighty victory through Christ? What a marvel! At once I realized that he whom I had thought to be in heaven was actually within me. I mean thee, O Christ, my creator and king. And then I knew that the victory was thine, which thou gavest me to overcome the devil. And as we humble ourselves, we're going to realize more and more all we're going to want to do is give thanks to God, because everything we have, every blessing, everything that's joyous in your life is a gift from God. He has given it to you. Give thanks. Give thanks. Make sure you give thanks. Moving on to the next section, I just want to read the few of these sections. I think they're really beautiful. This one's on the ongoing cleansing of his soul. This is, again, St. Simeon, the new theologian. For those joining, please smash that like if you would prefer. This is section 8 in the Discourses on the Mystical Grace of Thanksgiving. But I knew not yet, O Master, what thou had formest me from clay, hast bestowed these blessings on me. I knew not yet that thou was my God, free from pride, and my Lord. I had not yet been found worthy to hear thy voice, that I might know thee. Nor didst thou then mystically say to me, I am. For I was unworthy and unclean. The ears of my soul were as yet stopped with the clay of sin. My eyes were held by unbelief and ignorance. I think all of us can relate to what St. Simeon's talking about here. Unbelief and ignorance by the feelings of passion in its darkness. Thus I beheld thee, O my God. I did not know, nor did I previously believe that God was seen by anyone as far as it is possible to see thee. Nor did I consider that it was God, of God's glory, that from time to time was being shown to me, sometimes in one way, sometimes in the other. The unexpected marvel struck me with amazement. It filled my soul and my heart with joy, so much so that it seemed to me as though my body partook of the unspeakable grace. Yet I did not clearly recognize it was thee whom I saw. Hitherto I had frequently seen a light, at times within me, when my soul had enjoyed calmness and peace. At times it appeared to me externally from afar, or even it was completely hidden, and by its hiddenness caused me the unbearable pain of thinking I could not see it again. But when I lamented and wept and displayed complete solitude and obedience and humility, it appeared to me again. It was like the sun as it penetrates through the thickness of the mist and gradually shows itself a gently glowing sphere. Thus thou, the ineffable, the invisible, the impalpable, the immovable, who always art everywhere present in all things and fillest everything at all times, or if I may say so, by day and by night, art seen and art hidden. Thou goest away, thou comest. Thou doesn't vanish from sight, thou suddenly appearest. So bit by bit, thou didst scatter the darkness that was within me. Thou didst dispel the mist and dissolve the thickness. Thou didst cleanse the dim eyes of my intellect. And we're going to get to the noose. We're going to get to the noose here in a bit. Thou didst remove the barriers of my eyes and didst open them. Thou tookest away the veil of insensitivity. At the same time, thou didst put to sleep my all passion and ever fleshly pleasure and totally expel them from me. Having thus brought me to this state, thou didst clear the heaven of my ever mist. By the heaven, I mean the soul that thou hast cleansed in which thou comest invisibly. Thou who art everywhere present art suddenly found and manifested like another sun. O ineffable condensation. So how mystical. How mystical. Again, hesychasm is about realizing Christ within through silence, through darkness, through the investigation of oneself, through repentance, through humility. You find an uncreated light within yourself. You find the transcendent deity inside yourself. That's the point of all this stuff, but you don't have to annihilate your personhood to do it. You maintain your personhood. You maintain it. Here's section 9. Having taken hold of God in his simplicity. And let me shout out to Pano. He gave a great super chat earlier, and we're going to read it here at the end. I always get to the super chats at the end. But he said, our concept of divine simplicity is liturgical. We become one without being enveloped in each other. And that is exactly this maintaining of our personhood. That how is it that you and I, whatever, everybody that went to church today, everybody that participated in the divine liturgy, you are all of us are part of the body of Christ. We're one body, yet we're all these different people. I have my own body. You have your own body. How is it? It's a mystery. It's true union. It's true simplicity. And this right here. So here's St. Simeon, the new theologian, on God in his simplicity. Brethren, art the wonderful deeds of God toward us as we ascend to that which is more perfect, theosis. He who is without form or shape comes no longer without form or without shape, nor does he cause his light to come to us and be present with us in silence. But how? He comes in a definite form indeed, though it is a divine one. Yet God does not show himself in a particular pattern or likeness, but in simplicity, and takes the form of an incomprehensible, inaccessible, and formless light. We cannot possibly say or express more than this. Still, he appears clearly and is consciously known and clearly seen, though he is invisible. He sees and hears invisibly, and just as a friend speaks to friend face to face, so he, who by nature is God, speaks to those whom by grace he has begotten as gods. That is you and me. That is you and me. He loves like a father, and in turn he is fervently loved by his sons. Thus, for them he becomes a strange thing to behold and even more awesome to hear. For though he cannot be fittingly expressed in words by them, yet he cannot bear to be veiled by the silence. Is that not good or is that not good? I have some more sections here, but we're already over an hour. I don't know if I should read all this stuff or not. I'll go ahead and read it. Here is section 10, for the manifestations of the Spirit in the lives of the saints. Since the saints are constantly inflamed by longing for Him and mystically inspired by Him, God, they write sometimes to bewail the possessions of others. Sometimes they expose their own failures. And at times they recount with gratitude the blessings bestowed on them and the workings of grace. They sing theological hymns to praise Him who, by His divine working, has transformed them. At other times, if they hear anything that has been erroneously or falsely expressed concerning the salvation of our souls, they set it right in accordance with the measure of the knowledge that has been given to them. They put this in writing and bring in testimonies from the divine scriptures without being able to rest or be satisfied with that which has been expounded. How is it that they are able to do all these things? Because they are no longer their own, but they belong to the Holy Spirit who is in them. He moves them and is Himself moved by them. In them, He becomes all things by which you hear in divine scriptures concerning the kingdom of heaven, a pearl, a mustard seed, leavened bread, water, fire, the drink of life. He becomes a living fountain springing forth, a river flowing with spiritual words, word of divine life, a lamp, bed, marriage bed, wedding chamber, bridegroom, friend, brother, and father. But why do I try with many words to expound the whole matter? The terms are without number. For how can the tongue measure what the eye has not seen, nor the ear has not heard, nor the heart of man conceived, and express it in words? In no way whatever. For even if we possessed all these things within us, because we carry with us God who supplies them, yet we cannot measure with our minds, nor in any way explain them by word. St. Simeon the New Theologian. And this is his final resume, section 11, on the mystical grace of thanksgiving. These things were recorded, fathers and brethren, not for the sake of self-display. God forbid! For what we have is not ours to boast of, unless it were the sins committed by my mother's womb. The many impurities and transgressions which I think not even the sands of the sea could equal in number. It is God's marvelous deeds we declare and recount to you, though not as we ought, yet as we are able. In addition, we do this in order that we may, by this account, be of help to those who think that they have the Holy Scriptures unconsciously since divine baptism. For this discourse teaches us first of the total darkness and obscurity that at first prevails in us. That is, our alienation from the divine light. When it clearly goes as far as ignorance about God, then it describes the reproach and on the part of the conscience, then the fear, then the desire for the remission of debts. It directs the man who seeks a mediator and helper for this purpose, for no one is able to approach by himself without shame. All are burdened by the shame of many sins. Then how, by the intellectual illumination of the Holy Spirit, he obtains and sees a mediator and a shepherd and intercessor? The Spirit also shows him the beginning of the illumination into which he had not previously been initiated. But even though he has received this revelation, when the contemplation of the Spirit departs from him, he is deprived of it. He falls back into the darkness of many sins. After these things, our discourse has told of the second call that takes place through the shepherd, and then the subsequent obedience, faith, humility, and submission. How through these, bit by bit, a clear transformation takes place in our knowledge and our contemplation. He who has not recognized that change taking place in himself in accordance with the description of this discourse cannot possibly have the Holy Spirit dwelling within him. But as this discourse went over these things in detail, as I have said above, it gave us no occasion for pride, but rather we rejoiced in the marvelous works of God. These things he works out of pure goodness in those who seek him, quote, with all their soul and heart, so that every vain pretext and disobedience may receive its just retribution on the day when God will judge the race of mankind. To him is due all glory, honor, and adoration, now and always, forever and ever. Amen. Love it. So that is Saint Simeon, the new theologian. Now I'm going to turn this over to some Orthodox clergy to tell us a little bit about Hesychasm. And this is the tradition, the monastic, the mystical tradition founded by who we just read, Saint Simeon, the new theologian. So check this out. Now his audio may be a little low, so it may be a little hard to hear here, but let me know.
I'm going to digress a little because of a few questions that have been sent in. And I want to talk a little bit about the Philokalia and Hesychasm, because these are foundational in the Orthodox Church. And it's an interesting element about Hesychasm and Hesychastic prayer, and about the Palamite controversy. When we see the influence of Gnosticism in the deserts, among monastics in monasteries, we'll inevitably come up with stories that create a dichotomy between soul and body, an anthropological dualism, which has been soundly condemned by the Orthodox Church. When we look at the instructions of the Hesychastic Fathers and Hesychasm itself, and particularly elements of the debate between Balaam of Calabria and St. Gregory Palamas, the one thing that we notice immediately is that instead of having a dichotomy between soul and body, Hesychasm pulls the whole being of the person in and collects and gathers the person in the heart. And so far from having the soul function apart from the body and trying to take the soul out of the body for some kind of experience, this is condemned very strictly in Hesychastic theology and Hesychastic teaching. That when you'll read things like, if while you're praying you seem to be drifting outward from the body, then seize upon this and bring yourself back not only into the body but into the very depth, into the heart. Because the soul cannot depart the body except at death. There's no such thing as out-of-body experiences where the soul goes out of the body. And I know somebody will immediately talk about the experience of Apostle Paul, where he says, I know not. However, the Holy Fathers have already commented on that very strictly and have told us that, as a matter of fact, Paul did not have an out-of-body experience, but that the entire experience took place at home within his body, that his whole person participated, and that this was a noetic experience. And so we'll talk about that eventually, because questions will come up about it. But in Hesychastic prayer, we never allow even a semblance or even a seeming departure from the body. This journeying through astral planes and all its other theosophy and Gnosticism, where people seem to be able to send their soul out of the body and it has noetic, it has experiences of some kind. But all of these great experiences, St. Simeon the new theologian tells us of the great experience he had when he was completely penetrated by the divine light as a revelation of what happens to those who are yet alive at the time of the second coming and the general resurrection. And when he finishes describing this whole experience, he says, And I realized that I was there in the tabernacle of my body all the while. Never was he outside the body. The Gnostic idea that the body is somehow evil, that the soul is a prisoner of the body, that the body imprisons the soul, that the struggle is to release the soul from the body. All of this is heretical Manichaeism, and it is roundly condemned by every one of the fathers who wrote against the Manichaeists. And particularly in the Palamite controversy, it's one of the interesting twists about the debates between St. Gregory Palamas and Balaam the Calabrian, who came from Italy with his dry scholasticism and emptiness of any kind of inner spiritual life, that he was accusing St. Gregory Palamas and the Hesychasts. But what Balaam the Calabrian was defending was the very thing that the Cathars were being persecuted for back in Western Europe by the Latins. And among those were this kind of dualism. The Calabrian, speaking from a scholastic point of view, really thought that one could have no actual direct communion with God, that no one could know God in any way, that we came to God through types and symbols, through sacraments, which eventually in the West would get the magic number 7. The Orthodox Church has no teaching of 7 sacraments. And the Hesychast would argue, but of course we can know God. We can know God through Jesus Christ, first and foremost. But we know God also through his uncreated energies. We do not know the essence of God and do not draw nigh to the essence of God. But the uncreated energies of God, which are bestowed upon us, the divine grace, we can certainly know God and have a relationship with God in Jesus Christ and in the uncreated energies of God. Well, the Calabrian, being steeped in Western scholasticism, really could not comprehend the idea that we could actually have a relationship with God. And so this was a great part of the debates. Calabrian would also have a sense of metaphysical dualism and a anthropological dualism between soul and body, because there was so much Platonism in the West. And Plato's Phaedo would have formed a part of the theology of the relationship of soul and body in the Latin world. In the Orthodox Church, while the terminology of Plato is there, Plato has very little influence. And certainly his anthropological dualism, his idea that the soul is imprisoned in the body, was firmly and absolutely rejected by the Orthodox Church and by Hesychasm in particular. So one of the marks of a true Orthodox ascetic teaching is the fact that it does not make a conflict between soul and body. That we understand that we're speaking very often about the power of sin, which abides parasitically within us. But the body itself cannot sin. The body cannot think or plan or plot or even be tempted. The mind is what is tempted. And the body reacts to what the mind conceives. So we understand then that in Hesychasm, we try to bring our whole person, collect and gather our whole person within ourselves to find a wholeness of being. And this wholeness of being, we bring ourself, our mind, our nous, into the depth of our person, into our very heart. And this is what our real struggle is, to collect ourselves together that way. You see, when the Hesychast prays to bringing the nous into the depth of his person, what he's really achieving is wholeness of being, wholeness of personhood, so that his whole person is being transformed, that the whole person is already beginning to assimilate the grace of God and experience the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. And know ye not that your bodies are a temple? So our body is a temple. It is not an enemy. It was created by God, who looked upon it and said it is very good. And there is a condemnation in the councils of those who say that we'll have a different body than the one we dwelt in the heavenly kingdom. This body will be resurrected and will be reunited with the soul to enter the heavenly kingdom. So this is a mark of true hesychasm.
All right. Now I want to share also this video. Well, okay. Now that we looked a little bit at what hesychasm is, he talked about the noetic realm. What is the noose? So here is Ortho Wiki. I don't know if you guys know, there is such a thing as Orthodox Wiki. It is useful for some of these descriptions. Sometimes you actually find more fuller explanations on other sites. But I want to read to you guys the noose, the eye of the soul, the eye of the heart, and that we do have a knowability of God, but it's not up here. It's not the mind-body dualism of Cartesian dualism of Descartes. It's a unique understanding. It's not the noetic realm of Plato. It's not the noose of Plato. It's a different noose. This is a sanctified noose, okay? And the sanctification of this noose repositions it into the heart. And I've talked to you guys before, over and over again, that God communicates to us through our heart, not the mind. Although you can have these sort of downloads. I'm sure some of you guys have had these like aha moments where maybe you pray for something, maybe you're looking to connect some type of dot, and all of a sudden it all connects. God maybe answers a prayer. Things are connected. Well, this happens in the noetic realm of the heart, the noose. And so here I want to read this quick description of what the noose is to you guys, because this is essential to our mystical theology as Orthodox Christians. It's through the noose, that which we have to cleanse, that which can be darkened through our sin and our passions. But as we cleanse it, as we engage more directly with the uncreated energies of God, this thing is cleansed and we can see reality for what it is. We can see that which is unseeable more visibly. Well, that doesn't make any sense. That's the mystical dimension of our theology. So here it reads, in Orthodox Christianity, nous is the eye of the soul. Just as the soul of man is created by God, man's soul is intelligent and noetic. Saint Thessalonians wrote that God created beings, quote, with a capacity to receive the Spirit and to attain knowledge of himself. So God, being absolutely unknowable, as we will read a little bit here by Saint Dionysius, does give us the ability to come to know him. And we know him through the noos. This isn't the mind. We don't come to know God in an Orthodox theological context up here. We come to know God through here. So again, as St. Thessalonians write, with the capacity to receive the Spirit and to attain knowledge of himself, he has brought into existence the senses and sensory perception to serve such beings. Eastern Orthodox Christians hold that God did this by creating mankind with intelligence and noetic faculties. Angels have intelligence and nous, whereas men have reason, noose, and sensory perception. This what we were talking about this today in our Bible study with Subdeacon Mark after church today, of which you guys, if you follow me over on Telegram, you can join. Anybody can join us. We do it every Sunday and Wednesday night. But we were talking about the difference between the angels and mankind, and that we exist at a higher level than the angels, even though, as you're brought into the Orthodox Church through baptism or chrismation, you get a holy guardian angel. You get an angelic entity to look after you. But at the same time, this is why Satan is so jealous of you and I, because we have been given the beautiful, divine, eternal gift of becoming gods by grace. The angels don't have this gift. The angels don't have the gift of physicality to be in the created world for the purpose of becoming gods by grace. This is what you and I are called to. This is why the evil one is jealous. This is why the evil one wants to drag you and I with him down to the lake of fire after the judgment. And so this follows the idea that man is a microcosm and expression of the whole creation or the macrocosmos. It is through the healed and corrected noose and the intelligence that man knows and experiences God. In this belief, soul is created in the image of God. Since God is Trinitarian, mankind is noose, word, and spirit. The same is held true of the soul, or the heart. It has noose, word, and spirit. To understand this better, first an understanding of St. Gregory Palamas' teaching that man is a representation of the Trinitarian mystery should be addressed. This holds that God is not meant in the sense that the Trinity should be understood anthropomorphically, but man is to be understood in a triune divine way. You see, for us to actually know who we are, we have to know who God is, because it's His image that we're made in. God isn't made in our image. We can't anthropomorphize God and come to know God better. Only through, of course, yes, our God incarnated as a man, but we cannot anthropomorphize God to better understand Him. We can only understand our humanity through Christ's incarnation. But man is to be understood in a triune way, or that the Trinitarian God is not to be interpreted from the point of view of individual man, but man is interpreted on the basis of the Trinitarian God. And this interpretation is revelatory, not merely psychological and human. This means that it is only when a person is within the revelation, as all the saints lived, that he can grasp this understanding completely. The second presupposition is that mankind has and is composed of nous, word, and spirit, like the Trinitarian mode of being. Man's nous, word, and spirit are not hypostasis, or not a hypostasis, or individual existences or realities, but activities or energies of the soul. Whereas in the case with God or the persons of the Holy Trinity, each are indeed hypostases. So these three components of each individual man are inseparable from one another, but they do not have a personal character when speaking of the being that is mankind. The nous as the eye of the soul, which some fathers call the heart, is the center of man and is where true spiritual knowledge is validated. This is seen as true knowledge, which is implanted in the nous as always coexisting with it. And so from nous, let's jump over here to hesychasm. So we just listened to a gentleman talk about what the hesychastic tradition is, what is the hesychastic mystical purpose. And hesychasm is a mystical tradition of prayer in the Orthodox Church. It is described in great deal in the Filiocalia, a compilation of what various saints wrote about prayer in the spiritual life. Hesychasm may involve specific body postures and may be accompanied by deliberate breathing exercises. It involves acquiring an inner stillness, ignoring the senses. The hesychast interpreted Christ's injunction in the Gospel of Matthew to, quote, go into your closet and pray, to mean that they should move beyond the senses and withdraw inwards to pray. Hesychasm often includes repeating the Jesus prayer, Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. St. Theophan the Recluse once related that body postures and breathing techniques were virtually forbidden in his youth, since instead of gaining the Spirit of God, people succeeded in ruining their lungs. I thought that was hilarious. Gregory Palamas, defender of hesychasm. Hesychasm was defended theologically by Gregory Palamas, Saint Gregory Palamas, at about three separate Hesychastic nodes in Constantinople. From 1341 to 1351, St. Gregory was asked by his fellow monks on Mount Athos to defend it from the attacks of Barlaam, who advocated for a more intellectual Western approach to prayer. And here is St. John Climacus, who is famous for writing this particular book right here. The Ladder of Divine Ascent. So this is St. John Climacus. Although I would like to just say that the Ladder of Divine Ascent is not for everyone, meaning me as wanting to be a father and a family man and a lay Orthodox Christian, not exactly the most applicable teachings to my own life. As an Orthodox Christian, the first step of the divine ladder is to renounce the world. Well, I'm not trying to be a monk. So again, the divine ladder is a very powerful text within Orthodoxy, but not exactly not practical for the lay life. Let's just say that. So here is a quote from St. John Climacus, although I don't think I'm going to read it. But I did want to read this section right here. I thought this was really good. Hesychastic practice bears some superficial resemblance to the mystical prayer or meditation in Eastern religions. Example given, Buddhism and Hinduism, especially yoga. And this is where you'll see the perennialist online. You'll see the New Agers try to appropriate Orthodox hesychastic activity and equate it to Buddhist meditation or yogic practices. Although this similarity is often emphasized in popular accounts, while some might compare it with a mantra, to use the Jesus prayer in such a fashion is to violate its purpose. One is never to treat it as a string of syllables for which the, quote, surface meaning is secondary. Likewise, hollow repetition is considered to be worthless or even spiritually damaging in the hesychast tradition. And so, of course, nuance is always privileged. We want to be specific. We want to be nuanced in our approaches to this stuff because nuance is how we understand the beauty of Orthodoxy. And so all this stuff leads to the process of theosis. Not all of us are going to be hesychastic monks, that's for sure. But all of us should be attempting to attain full theosis, however that's going to be. And so you can be lay, you can be married and have kids and attain theosis. What is theosis? Well, you've heard me talk about it over and over again. Theosis is a process of a worshiper becoming free of hamartia, missing the mark, being united with God, beginning in this life and later consumed in bodily resurrection. For Orthodox Christians, theosis is salvation. Theosis assumes that humans from the beginning are made to share in the life or nature of the Holy Trinity. We are from the beginning, as St. Maximus said, for the purpose Christ was always going to incarnate, whether we fell from grace or not, whether we fell from the Garden of Eden or not, Christ was going to incarnate because the purpose was theosis. Therefore, an infant or an adult worshiper is saved from the state of unholiness for participation in life, which is everlasting. This is not to be confused with the heretical apotheosis or deification in God's essence, which all the other forms of mysticism are going to promote. They're all going to promote an apotheotic purpose of the mystical reality, that the purpose of mysticism, whether it be yoga, whether it be Buddhism, whether it be entheogenic sacraments, psychedelics, all this different stuff, shamanism, the point is to realize that you're God in essence. You're the universe waking up to the joyful slumber that you put yourself under so you could briefly forget the whole mystery that you're the entire universe who chose your parents and chose your body and chose everything about your life. But then what if everything is kind of dreary and terrible? Well, you chose it according to these people. This is a heresy. This is not what we believe. Here is the Orthodox theology of theosis. Let me read this. The statement by St. Athanasius, the Son of God became man that we might become God. The second G is always lowercase, since man can never become a, quote, God, capital K, capital uppercase G indicates the concept beautifully. 2 Peter 1:4 says that we have become, quote, partakers of divine nature, unquote. Athanasius amplifies the meaning of this verse when he says theosis is, quote, becoming by grace what God is by nature. What would otherwise seem absurd, that fallen sinful man may become holy as God is holy, has been made possible through Jesus Christ, who is God incarnate. Naturally, the crucial Christian assertion that God is one sets an absolute limit on the meaning of theosis. It is not possible for any created being to become ontologically God or even another God. Through theoria, this is illumination. This is a stage in the hesychastic practice. The knowledge of God is Jesus Christ. Human beings come to know the experience, what it means to be fully human, the created image of God. Through their communion with Jesus Christ, God shares himself with the human race in order to conform them to all that God is in knowledge, righteousness, and holiness. Theosis also asserts the complete restoration of all people and the entire creation in principle. This is built upon the understanding of the atonement put forward by Irenaeus of Lyons called recapitulation. Although how we understand that, that can be a little tricky. Full recapitulation is Satan going to go to heaven? Is everybody going to be saved? Some people understand that as the apokatastasis, the full recapitulation. Obviously, Satan's choice inside eternity is going to condemn him in eternity. So not everybody is recapitulated. Not everybody is saved. So we have to put parentheses around this concept and make sure we know what's being said here. For many fathers, theosis goes beyond simply restoring people to their state before the fall of Adam and Eve, teaching that because Christ united the human and divine natures in his person, it is now possible for someone to experience closer fellowship with God than Adam and Eve initially experienced in the Garden of Eden, and that people can become more like God than Adam and Eve were at that time. Some Orthodox theologians go so far as to say that Jesus would have become incarnate for this reason alone, even if Adam and Eve had never sinned, most notably St. Maximus the Confessor. All of humanity is fully restored in the full potential of humanity because the Son of God took to himself a human nature to be born of a woman and takes to himself also the sufferings due to sin, yet it is not himself a sinful man and is God unchanged in his being. In Christ, the two natures of God and human are not two persons but one. Thus a union is effected in Christ between all of humanity and God. So the holy God and sinful humanity is reconciled in principle in one sinless man, Jesus Christ. This reconciliation is made actual through the struggle to conform to the image of Christ. Without the struggle, the praxis, there is no real faith. Faith leads to action, without which it is dead. One must unite will, thought, and action to God's will, his thoughts and his actions. A person must fashion his life to be a mirror, a true likeness of God. More than that, since God and humanity are more than a similarity and Christ, but rather a true union, Christians' lives are more than mere imitation and are rather a union with the life of God himself. So that the one who is working out salvation is united with God, working within the penitent both to will and to do that which pleases God. That's what we read by St. Simeon the New Theologian when he resists the temptation, when he reflects on that later in the day, and he realizes it was Christ within himself that saved him. St. Gregory Palamas affirmed the possibility of humanity's union with God in his energies, while also affirming that because of God's transcendence and utter otherness, it is impossible for any person or other creature to know or be united with God's essence. Yet through faith, we can attain the phronema, or understanding, of the faith of the church. The journey towards theosis includes many forms of praxis, living in the community of the church and partaking regularly of the sacraments, and especially the Eucharist, is taken for granted. Also important is cultivating prayer of the heart and prayer that never ceases, as Paul exhorts in Thessalonians 1 and 2. This unceasing prayer of the heart is a dominant theme in the writings of the fathers, especially in those collected in the Filioquia. Why prayer of the heart? Because what did we just talk about? The nous. We were just talking about the definition of the nous, that knowledge of God in an Orthodox mystical context comes through the eye of the heart, the eye of the soul, right through here. God doesn't communicate through you here, although it is intelligible. So when God communicates to you through your heart, it is intelligible, yes. It is, it's not just pure emotion, right? There's rationale to it as well, but it's through the heart. It's through the heart. So now I want to show you this this one right here. And check this out. This is Mysticism in the Orthodox Church.
So Hannah D. asks, I'd like to know how you define mysticism in the context of the Orthodox tradition. Should I read the rest of this?
No, mysticism. Let me talk about mysticism, because I think that one of the things that Orthodoxy has preserved by comparison to Roman Catholicism, as well as especially the Protestants, because Roman Catholicism may have some mystical aspects to it, but Roman Catholicism has completely thrown it away in the sense of... Protestantism has completely thrown it away by becoming very rationalistic and becoming very... they focused on the word, they focused on knowledge, they focused on understanding, and that is not enough in the relationship with God, because God is beyond our comprehension. And this is where mysticism comes in, where what is mysticism? Is the way we know that God is present and that God exists without necessarily understanding it. For example, we call the sacraments in the Orthodox Church, we call them mysteries, mysteria, where the mystical aspect is focused on or is shown as being the aspect of those sacraments, of those events. What is a sacrament? Which includes Holy Communion and the Eucharist. It includes, say, the blessing of the water. It includes confession. It includes all the sacraments that we know, and sacraments that people don't think they're sacraments, because sometimes we focus on seven, but the Orthodox Church never limited the sacraments to seven, because even the funeral, which is only given to Orthodox Christians, is a sacrament. Even, of course, the great blessing of the water for Epiphany, tonsure of monks and nuns, all these are sacraments. So in a sacrament, God is present in a mystical way that our senses cannot perceive. We can only know through our heart. We can only know through him touching us in a special way as he is present to change, say, the bread and the wine and make it the body and blood of Christ, to change the water and make it holy water, to change this person and make them a priest in the sacrament of ordination, to change a person, make them a monk or a nun in the sacrament of the cura, the tonsure of the monastics. So mysticism is really at the center of the understanding of who we are and who God is, because God is present in a mystical way throughout our lives. And we emphasize that. I think a good book to read, which gives in the conversations with the monk, whose name is Maximus in that book, the author of the book, he's asking questions and he's getting answers from the monk, the book of called The Mountain of Silence. In that book, you will see the mystical aspects of the church as the monk Maximus describes them. And that is a great book to read for anyone, especially coming from the Protestant world, who wants to understand mysticism in the Orthodox Church. That monk gives a great description of the mystical aspects of Christianity, of Orthodox Christianity, which the others have lost to a great extent.
So I love that. That is the last video that I was going to show you, but I have a couple great, I just have too much to read, so I wanted to show you guys. I don't think I'm going to read this one. This is a great article, though, by Vladimir Lasky. Lasky's a great Orthodox theologian, and he wrote this article on the theology and mysticism in the church, in the tradition of the Eastern Church. Let me share this with you guys. So I'm going to copy it. I'm going to throw this down in the live chat. And if you guys have time in the future, you can go read this. It is a great article. I was going to read it, but it's a bit of a longer one. I still wanted to read the mystical theology of St. Dionysius. I feel like I can't have a stream on Orthodox theology of mysticism without reading the mystical theology of St. Dionysius. So I really want to read this. But there's another great article that I found, and here I'll share this link with you guys as well here in the live chat. So anybody in the live chat, you can check that out. So this one is on the Orthodox Mysticism Teachings of the Desert Fathers. And so it kind of recaps some of the stuff that we've already talked about, that in the Eastern Church, contemplation consisted not merely in negation and renunciation, the emphasis in Western Catholicism, but in a deifying union with God's Spirit and the experience of spiritual illumination, theoria, after all intellectual activity had ceased. The emphasis on deification, called theosis, had many definite and practical activist applications to ordinary life in the world. If it were possible for me to find a leper, said one of the Desert Fathers, and to give him a body and to take his, I would gladly do it, for this is perfect love, unquote. Such was the true nature of theosis, or deification. Visions were practically non-existent in mystical theology in the Eastern Church. Distractions to prayer, whether voluntary or involuntary, were to be deplored and dismissed with whenever possible. And visions and ecstasies were considered to be involuntary distractions to prayer. Those experiences which later mystics sought after and prized so highly were considered by the earlier Christians as little more than nuisances to be suspiciously examined and barely tolerated. Now, obviously, the tradition of Hesychasm was very much interested in visible light. This is what St. Simeon the New Theologian is very much interested in. He has a whole theology of the divine light. And so we're going to find different emphasis on mysticism from the Desert Fathers than maybe the Hesychastic tradition or St. Simeon the New Theologian. So I only read that because the visions are actually, the visions of uncreated light are pretty prominent in the Hesychastic tradition. So anyways, the Hesychasts, from the Greek Hesychia, meaning quiet and solitude, were championed by Gregory Palamas, Archbishop of Thessalonica. His teachings were confirmed by two councils held at Constantinople in 1341 and 1351, which, although local and not ecumenical, possesses a doctrinal authority even today in the Orthodox Church, scarcely inferior to the seven general councils themselves. Palamas' teachings must be understood before one can begin to understand the tradition of the Eastern mystics, whose position and practice he merely articulated and defended. And so this is on Barlaam. Barlaam's views were influenced not only by scholasticism, but by the teachings of the Greek father Dionysius the Areopagite, who held that God was totally other, unquote. Barlaam reasoned that God could only be known indirectly, and a direct experience, such as the Hesychast claimed, was clearly impossible. He seized upon the bodily exercises which the Hesychasts use as evidence of their grossly materialistic view of prayer, and to bolster his derision of their, quote, belly button theology. Why? Because they would look down and pray. Now, again, you see with Barlaam here a dialectical tension, that somehow the body is bad. That God, again, a fuller understanding of orthodoxy is that God is totally other in essence, i.e. St. Dionysius the Areopagite, but God's energies and Christ and the Holy Spirit can confront us on a personal level. All the Eastern mystics believed that the supreme spiritual experience would be a vision of the divine and uncreated light, was identical with the Jewish Shekinah and the light witnessed by the three disciples which surrounded Jesus on Mount Tabor at his transfiguration, the Taboric light. This completely scandalized Barlaam, who maintained that God's essence was invisible and therefore any light the Hesychasts saw was a natural created light of their making. No, the light is uncreated. The light is uncreated just like his energies are. This light is one of his energies. It's eternally uncreated. Gregory Palamas proved himself to be a creative theologian of the first rank by explaining that there is a difference between God's essence and God's energies. St. Basil the Great had written in Letter 234, quote, "We know our God from his energies, but we do not claim that we can draw near to his essence. For his energies come down to us, but his essence remains unapproachable," unquote. Thus, Gregory explained God's transcendence in terms of his essence and his immanence in terms of his energies. It is by means of his energies that God dwells with man. His energies are synonymous with his grace. God exists in his energies, and therefore grace is not merely a gift of an object God bestows, but it is himself communicating himself to men in his energies. Even though he believed that God is not a nature, for he is above all nature, he is not a being, for he is above all beings. No single thing or that which is created has ever or will have even the slightest communion with the supreme nature or nearness to it. Gregory still maintained that saints were, quote, deified by the grace of God through direct experience. They know God, not his essence, but his energies. Now I hope everything I've been talking about in this stream is coming together. But because God is light, reference to 1 John 1:5, the experience of his energies was said to take the form of light, an uncreated Taboric light. The Hesychast vision is not of a mere created light, but the light of the Godhead itself, identical with the uncreated light that surrounded the transfigured Christ on Tabor. Even though this light is not a sensible or material light, it can be seen by a man whose senses as well as his soul have been transformed. A unique body, mind-body philosophy of Eastern Christians is also important to note, for it played a large part in the practice of mysticism. Mind-body, talking about the noose. The noose. This is why I wanted to talk about the noose. And so there's so much you can go through here. This is the prayer of the heart or the Jesus prayer. I can read, this prayer was prayed by the Hesychasts with attention to breathing and posture. It recommended posture that was with the head bowed, chin on chest, eyes fixed on the heart. The obvious parallel between this method of prayer and the technique of Hindu yoga is interesting, but should not be equated by any means. The rationale behind the breathing and postures are different, and the Hesychasts were more frankly hypnotic, i.e., they admittedly used it as an aid to concentration, whereas the yogis embellished the whole procedure with a theory of chakras to justify it. So moving a little bit further down, Theoleptus, Metropolitan of Philadelphia, lived in the reign of Andronicus, the second Paleologus, around the 1324 AD. He is the spiritual teacher of Gregory Palamas. One of his teachings, typical of the mind-body emphasis of the Hesychasts, was do not neglect kneeling. Kneeling represents falling into sin, implying also confession of sin. Rising up from the knees represents repentance, suggesting a vow of virtuous life. Each time you kneel, make a mental invocation of Christ, casting yourself, body and soul, at the feet of the Lord to incline the God of souls and bodies favorably toward you. His emphasis on body and soul was no mere figure of speech. He intended it to be applied quite literally. And so, again, this document goes on. It's a really good document. It really has great, great stuff. This is on Source for the Teachings of the Desert Fathers. Here's St. Basil the Great emphasized that God does not dwell in man's fantasies or imagination any more than he dwells in a building. Therefore, the practice of mental picturing of divine things is to be discouraged. Why? Think of St. Ignatius and his teachings on prayer. Highly emotional, highly imaginative. We again, the imagination is the realm. This is the battlefield. This is where you're battling your temptations. This is where you're battling evil spirits. This is where you're battling demons. It's in your imagination. All the sins you've committed, you thought about before the passions arose, before you actually engaged in any of them. You have to be careful of your mental images. And so that's why God doesn't communicate through our mental images. He communicates through our noose, of which when we engage with his energies, we begin to purify that noose so we can better communicate with him. Gregory the theologian said, God demands the following three virtues from every man who is baptized: for the soul, true faith; for the body, chastity; for the tongue, truth. It is more essential to remember God than to breathe. You must think of God more often than you breathe. Now, I certainly am not there. I guess I'm working on that. But I did love that for the soul, it's faith; for the body, it's chastity; and for the tongue, it's truth. If you engage in those things, you will probably be saved. You would probably be saved, especially if you remember God and pray as often as you breathe. St. John Chrysostom, whose liturgy is celebrated in all Eastern Orthodox churches and Roman Catholic churches of the Byzantine Rite, and whose eloquence and pragmatism made him the most outstanding leader of the Eastern Church, wrote a 7 discourse on 2 Corinthians. And so here is St. John Chrysostom. We're going to read this. Do you wish to see how the inner light penetrates even through their bodies? And looking steadfastly at Stephen, they saw his face as it had been the face of an angel, Acts 6:15. But this is as nothing compared to the glory which some shone within him. For what Moses showed is in his face, they carried in their souls. And much more than that, for what Moses had was more physical, whereas this was spiritual. Just as bodies which can receive and reflect light, when illuminated by self-radiant bodies themselves, pour their reflected light on other bodies close to them. So it is with believers. This is why those with the experience become detached from the earthly and think only of heavenly things. But alas, we ought even to understand what is said about it, because we quickly lose it and incline to the sensory. This ineffable and terrible glory remains in us 1 or 2 days, after which we extinguish it, bringing in the storms of worldly affairs and the thick clouds which repulse its rays. The bodies of men who have pleased God will be vested with such glory as our present eyes cannot even see. Certain signs and vague traces of this were graciously given by God, both in the Old and New Testaments. There the face of Moses shone with such glory as the eyes of the Israelites could not bear, while in the New Testament the face of Christ shone with a still greater light. Mm-hmm. Speaking of the Jesus prayer, St. John Chrysostom advised, I implore you, brethren, never break or despise the rule of this prayer. A monk, when he eats, drinks, sits, officiates, travels, does anything other than continually cry, Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon me. So the name of the Lord Jesus, descending into the depths of the heart, should subdue the serpent ruling over the inner pastures and bring life and salvation to his soul. He should always live with the name of the Lord Jesus, so that the heart absorbs the Lord and the Lord the heart, and the two become one. And so, let's see, there's so much down here. Here's the meaning of asceticism. Here's quoting Maximus. Whenever I see Maximus the Confessor, I'm always quick to read it. Quoting Maximus the Great, St. Maximus the Confessor declared, quote, there are three different purposes for which gifted men write about fault or constraint. The first as memoranda for themselves. The second for the benefit of others. The third for obedience. With the last purpose, many writings have been composed for those who humble and seek the word of truth. But he who writes to please men or for fame or for display loses and will receive no profit from this either here or in the life to come. More, he will be condemned as a sycophant and a wicked approacher of the word of God. Here's the psychology of a mystic. Again, this is a great document, guys. You should check it out. A lot of good stuff here. Here, then St. Maximus the Confessor expounds a little on what might be called the psychology of the mystic. Quote, the mind is the organ of wisdom. Reason is the organ of knowledge. Natural conviction derived from both is the organ of faith formed in accordance with both of them. Natural love of men is the organ of the gift of healing. For each divine gift of grace, there is a corresponding natural organ capable of receiving it as experience or as power or as predisposition. St. Isaac of Syria. First of all, let us force ourselves to abstain from speech. Then from this abstinence will be born in us something which leads to silence itself. May God grant you the experience of this something born of this abstinence. But if you embrace this life, I cannot tell you how much light it will bring you. Well, I'm pretty screwed there. A life of not speaking or speech, that's going to be tough for me. Anyways, again, guys, there's a lot of great stuff here. Further definitions are given of a particular for emphasis on the renunciation of the products of one's own imagination. What did I talk about? Not the imagination. God communicates to us through the heart. Repentance is a complete and voluntary dying to everything. A compassionate heart is a heart burning for every creature, for men, birds, animals, for demons, and all creation. Silence kills the outer senses but brings inner movements to life. External contacts produce the opposite effect. That is, they bring to life the outer senses and kill inner movements. Let's see. We should constantly realize that in every one of these 24 hours of a day and night, we need of repentance. The meaning of the word repentance, as we have learned from the true quality of things, is the following. It is unflagging petition to God, addressed to him in prayer, full of contrition, begging him to overlook the past. It is also a concern about protecting the future. Signs of religious ecstasy. Maximus the Confessor emphasized the absolute necessity of grace for the mystical life, as did all those prior to him. He integrated mysticism into the whole of Christian theology, and most of his contemporaries also wrote about their mysticism with careful attention to its theological aspects. Somewhat later, as in the writings of St. Simeon the New Theologian, the emphasis slightly shifts. Although only those with mystical experiences qualify as leaders of the church, the Christ-centered mysticism of which he speaks was considered a natural flowering of the contemplative life in its fullness rather than as an extraordinary gift. Cataphatic and apophatic theology. Of course, we know what that is. And with that being said, I think we're going to close today's stream with a reading of the Mystical Theology by St. Dionysius. Guys, if you could, if you appreciate what we're doing here on Church of the Eternal Logos, if you appreciated this stream, please super chat using the Streamlabs link, or if you prefer YouTube, use the YouTube link. But I would, again, greatly appreciate, only if you're able, any contribution helps. Again, we're going to conclude this stream with the Mystical Theology of St. Dionysius, And so if you appreciated tonight's stream, if you'd like to support, feel free by sending in a super chat via Streamlabs. Would greatly, greatly appreciate that. Okay. Chapter 1 of The Mystical Theology by St. Dionysius. Why is this so important? Because this is the real source of our apophatic unknowability of God's essence. This is a great understanding of mysticism. And so, like I said, it's only 7 pages and they're not full pages. So we're going to zoom right through this. Chapter 1. What is divine darkness? Trinity, higher than any being. any divinity, any goodness, guide of Christians in the wisdom of heaven. Let us up, lead us up beyond unknowing and light, up to the farthest, highest peak of mystic scripture, where the mysteries of God's logos lie simple, absolute, and unchangeable in the brilliant darkness of a hidden silence. Amid the deepest shadow, they pour overwhelming light on what is most manifest. Amid the holy, unsensed, and unseen, they completely fill our sightless minds with treasures beyond all beauty. For this I pray. And Timothy, my friend, my advice to you as you look for a sight of the mysterious things is to leave behind your everything perceived and understood, everything perceptible and understandable, all that is not and all that is, and with your understanding lay aside to strive upward as much as you can toward union with Him who is beyond all being and knowledge. By an undivided and absolute abandonment of yourself and everything, shedding all and freed from all, you will be uplifted to the ray of the divine shadow, which is above everything that is. But see to it that none of this comes to the hearing of the uninformed. That is to say, to those caught up with the things of the world, who imagine that there is nothing beyond instances of individual being, who think that their own intellectual resources, that they can have direct knowledge of Him who has made the shadows His hiding place. If an initiation into the divine is beyond such people, what is to be said of those others, still more uninformed, who describe the transcendent cause of all things in terms of derived from the lowest orders of being, and who claim that it is in no way superior to the godless, multiform shapes they themselves have made? What has actually to be said about the cause of everything is this. Since it is the cause of all beings, we should posit and ascribe to it all affirmations we make in regard to beings, and more appropriately, we should negate all these affirmations since it surpasses all things. We should not conclude that the negations are simply the opposites of affirmations, but rather that the cause of all is considerably prior to this, beyond privations, beyond every denial, beyond every assertion. This, at least, is what was taught by the blessed Bartholomew. He says the logos of God is vast and minuscule, that the gospel is wide-ranging and yet restricted. To me, it seems that in this, he is extraordinarily shrewd. For he has grasped that the good cause of all is both eloquent and taciturn, indeed wordless. It is neither word nor act of understanding, since it is on a plane above all this, and it is made manifest only to those who travel through foul and fair, who pass beyond the summit of every holy ascent, who leave behind them every divine light, every voice, every word from heaven, and who plunge into the darkness, whereas Scripture proclaims there dwells the one who is beyond all things. It is not for nothing that the blessed Moses is commanded to submit first to purification and then to depart from those who have not undergone this. When every purification is complete, he hears the many voiced trumpets, he sees the many lights, pure with the rays streaming abundantly. Then, standing apart from the crowds and accompanied by chosen priests, he plunges ahead to the summit of the divine ascents. And yet he does not meet God himself, but contemplates. He, not him who is invisible, but rather where he dwells. This means, I presume, that the holiest and highest of things perceived by the eye of the body or the mind are but the rationale which presupposes all that lies below the transcendent one. Through them, however, his unimaginable presence is shown, walking the heights of those holy places to which the mind at least can rise. But then he, Moses, breaks free of them, away from what sees and what is unseen. He plunges into the truly mysterious darkness of unknowing. Here, renouncing all that the mind may conceive, wrapped entirely in the intangible and the invisible, he belongs completely to him who is beyond everything. Here, neither oneself nor someone else, one who is supremely united to the completely unknown by inactivity of all knowledge, and knows beyond the mind by knowing nothing. Chapter 1. Now this is chapter 2. Again, we, for those of you who joined, smash that like. This is The Mystical Theology by St. Dionysius the Areopagite. Chapter 2, How One Should Be United and Attribute Praises to the Cause of All Things Who is Beyond All Things. I pray we could come to this darkness so far above light, if only we lacked sight and knowledge so as to see, so as to know, unseeing and unknowing, that which lies beyond all vision and knowledge. For this would really to see and to know, to praise the transcendent one in a transcending way, namely through the denial of all beings. We would like sculptors who set out to carve a statue. They remove every obstacle to the pure view of the hidden image, and simply by this act of clearing aside, they show up the beauty which is hidden. Now it seems to me that we should praise the denials quite differently than we do the assertions. When we made assertions, we began with first things, moved down through intermediate terms until we reached the last things. But now as we climb from the last things up to the most primary, we deny all things, so that we may unhiddenly know the unknowing, which itself is hidden from all those possessed of knowing amid all beings, so that we may see above being that darkness concealed from all light among beings. I love that. Apophatic theology, negative theology, right? When we perform the apophatic theology, it's like a sculptor. We're taking away. We can't know God, but by moving from first things to last things in a cataphatic way, we can get to the last things and move from there in an apophatic way to that which transcends, like a sculptor, seeing that which was hidden in the marble, the beauty that was hidden in the marble. I love that analogy. Now this is chapter 3, chapter 3 of the Mystical Theology of St. Dionysius. What are the affirmative theologies and what are the negative? Good question. Chapter 3. In my theological representations, I have praised the notions which are most appropriate to affirmative theology. I have praised the notions which are most appropriate to affirmative theology. I have shown the sense in which the divine and good nature is said to be one and then triune, how fatherhood and sonship are predicated of it, the meaning of the theology of the Spirit, how these core lights of goodness grew from the incorporeal and indivisible good, and how in this sprouting they have remained inseparable from their co-eternal foundation in it, in themselves, and in each other. I have spoken of how Jesus, who is above all individual being, became a being with a true human nature. Other revelations of Scripture were also praised in the theological representations. In the divine names, I have shown the sense in which God is described as good, existent, life, wisdom, power, and whatever other thing pertained to the conceptual names of God. In my symbolic theology, I have discussed analogies of God drawn from what we perceive. I have spoken of the images that we have of Him, and of the forms, figures, and instruments proper to Him, of the places in which He lives, and the ornaments He wears. I have spoken of His anger, grief, and rage, of how He is said to be drunk and hungover, of His oaths and curses, of His sleeping and waking, and indeed of all those images we have of Him, images shaped by the workings of the symbolic representations of God. And I feel sure that you have noticed how these latter come much more abundantly than what went before, since the theological representations in a discussion of the names appropriate to God are inevitably briefer than what can be said in the symbolic theology. The fact is that the more we take flight upward, the more our words are confined to the ideas we are capable of forming, so that now as we plunge into the darkness, which is beyond intellect, we shall find ourselves not simply running short of words, but actually speechless and unknowing. In the earlier books, my arguments traveled downward from the most exalted to the humblest categories, taking in on this downward path an ever-increasing number of ideas which multiplied with every stage of the descent. But my argument now rises from what is below up to the transcendent. And the more it climbs, the more language falters. And when it has passed up and beyond the ascent, it will turn silent completely, since it will finally be at one with him who is indescribable. Now you may wonder, why is it that, after starting out from the highest category when our method involved assertions, we begin now from the lowest category when it involves denial? The reason is this. When we assert what is beyond every assertion, we must then proceed from what is most akin to it. And as we do, as we do so, we make the affirmation on which everything else depends. But when we deny that which is beyond every denial, we have to start by denying those qualities which differ from the goal we hope to attain. It is not closer to reality to say that God is life and goodness rather than that he is air or stone. It is not more accurate to deny that drunkenness and rage can be attributed to him than to deny that we can apply to him the terms of speech and thought. That was chapter 3. Now we're moving into chapter 4 of the Mystical Theology by St. Dionysius. Chapter 4, that the supreme cause of every perceptible thing is not itself perceptible. So this is what we say. The cause of all is above all and is not inexistent, lifeless, speechless, mindless. It is not a material body and hence has neither shape nor form, quality, quantity, or weight. It is not in any place and can neither be seen nor touched. It is neither perceived nor it is perceptible. It suffers neither disorder nor disturbance, and it is overwhelmed by no earthly passion. It is not powerless and subject to the disturbances caused by sense perception. It endures no deprivation of light. It passes through no change, decay, division, loss, no ebb or flow, nothing of which the senses may be aware. None of this can either be identified with nor attributed to it. That was chapter 4. Chapter 5, last chapter. This is the very end of the Mystical Theology of St. Dionysius the Areopagite, last chapter, that the supreme cause of every conceptual thing is not itself conceptual. Think about that. The supreme cause, God, of every conceptual thing is not itself conceptual. Again, as we climb higher, we say this: it is not soul or mind, nor does it possess imagination, conviction, speech, or understanding. Nor is it per se understanding per se. It cannot be spoken of, and it cannot be grasped by understanding. It is not a number or order, greatness or smallness, equality or inequality, similarity or dissimilarity. It is not immovable, moving, or at rest. It has no power. It is not power, nor is it light. It does not live, nor is it life. It is not a substance, nor is it eternity or time. It cannot be grasped by the understanding, since it is neither knowledge nor truth. It is not kingship. It is not wisdom. It is neither one nor oneness, divinity nor goodness. Nor is it a spirit, in the sense in which we understand that term. It is not sonship or fatherhood, and it is nothing known to us or any other thing. It falls neither within the predicate of non-being nor of being. Existing beings do not know it as it actually is, and it does not know them as they are. There is no speaking of it, nor name or knowledge of it. Darkness and light, error and truth, it is none of these. It is beyond assertion and denial. We make assertions and denials of what is next to it, but never of it. For it is both beyond every assertion, being the perfect and unique cause of all things, and by virtue of its preeminently simple and absolute nature, free of every limitation, beyond every limitation, and it is also beyond every denial. That is the Mystical Theology of St. Dionysius the Areopagite. And with that being said, that concludes tonight's stream, The Transcendent Theology of Orthodox Mysticism. A jam-packed stream with tons of information, some of which I'm sure many of you guys had already heard, known about. But I hope it was useful. I hope there was new things. I hope there was some stuff to be shared. So, anyways, now I'm going to read some super chats. First super chat comes from our good Greek Ortho brother, Pano Prano. God bless you, brother. Love you. Hope all is well. We got to meet up soon and go to liturgy together. God bless you, man. Hope everything's going good. Pano throws in a super chat and says, our concept of divine simplicity is liturgical. We become one without being enveloped into each other. That is absolutely the case, as I was talking about earlier. Again, when you belong to the body of Christ, you're one body, yet you're multiple persons. How is that? How is that? This is because of our personhood. This is because we're made in the image of God. Our personhood should never be destroyed. We're saved through our personhood. We're judged through our personhood. When we come to judgment day, if we're just this abstract ethereal God or divinity, who's being judged? When you sin, when you kill somebody, when you do XYZ, who's at fault? If the real nature of reality is that you're the universe, that you're God, and that the whole illusion of who you think you are is the problem, then who's guilty of murder? God is? Well, that doesn't make sense. And so that whole destructive form of mysticism, which, again, most religions kind of have this structure, it falls apart. It doesn't really make a whole lot of sense. It doesn't really make a whole lot of sense. So shout out to Pano, great friend, ortho brother. Hope all's going well, man. Fellow Hoosier, of course. So great, great comment. Our concept of divine simplicity is liturgical. We become one without being enveloped into each other. Pano throws in another super chat and says, as a fan of St. John, you'll love this. Meditate on every verse. Absolutely do love that. And we kind of do that. For those of you who have been joining our theology courses on Wednesday nights, we also do Orthodox Bible study, of which we're working through the book of Ephesians. We just finished chapter 2 today, so we'll be starting chapter 3 of Ephesians next Sunday, where we work through it with my godfather, Subdeacon Mark. And anybody is welcome to join. You have to follow me over on my Telegram. That's the only way you'll be invited, because I post the Zoom link through my Telegram. Whether you follow my personal Telegram or my Telegram group chat, let me share that. You can follow me on Telegram, and every Wednesday night at just around 7 o'clock, I share the Zoom link for our theology course, of which we've been having more members. Again, everybody's welcome. Anybody who wants can come. Anyways, anybody can come on the Wednesday night courses. And we do theology Wednesday night, and we do Bible study Sunday. So if anybody would like to join us, that is open to everybody. Just follow my Telegram, personal Telegram, the Church of Eternal Logos, or my group chat. I also tend to share the link in Michael Sisko's group chat as well. So if anybody would like to join us there, you can do so. and then let's see here. Okay. And another super chat comes from Mikhail, the King of Kings, donates and says, God bless you, DPH. I would very much love if you did a stream completely dedicated to the topic of Hezekiah. I feel drawn to this way of being and appreciate it if you and Father Peter hears or Father Deacon Ananias would dive deep on this topic. That might be a worthy stream, Mikhail, King of Kings. Certainly, Hezekiah is worth diving into a little bit more. And You know, for me, the monastic, the overly ascetic life, I typically am not too drawn to reading stuff myself. I'm very much interested. You know, I feel like there's an absence to a degree on online Orthodoxy to talking about lay life. For example, I want to do a stream on Orthodox theology of money. And so I was thinking about doing that, and I started quickly looking at some stuff online. And what did I find? Really nothing about, like, okay, if you're a family man, if you have kids, if you have a wife, how should you understand money? How should you use money? How should money be understood in regards to investments, about saving money for the future? How do we understand that in a lay context where money is important? Mostly all I could find was articles about mammon and how money is the root of all evil, and that you shouldn't worship money. And it's like, well, how do we talk about money as Orthodox lay people where we're not worshiping it? And so I was really looking for more stuff on that. And I only say that because it reminds me of, like, the divine ladder, the ladder of divine ascent. Very, very overly ascetic. Doesn't seem too practical for my own spiritual life. But diving in a little deeper on Hezekiah, that would be, let me write that down. Let me write it down. I got a bunch of topics in the back of my little notebook here. So I'll put deep dive into Hesychasm. So, all right. Well, Mikhail, King of Kings, you got your wish. I'll write that down. And I will definitely, I could potentially reach out to Father Peter Hears whenever he's free sometime. That would be a good stream. Diving into the Hesychasm with Father Peter Hears. That would be a good one. That would be a very good one. So thank you, Mikhail, King of Kings, for your super chat. Greatly appreciate it, brother. Thomas Henderson throws in a super chat. Thank you so much, Thomas Henderson. Thank you for your support, brother. He says, your sharing of books and reading them is a real blessing to us listeners. I'll have to watch this again from the beginning to cover what I missed. Keep up the good work, my friend. Well, thank you so much, Thomas Henderson, for your support. Thank you for your super chat. The goal is to, like Jay Dyer says, to do your homework for you. So essentially, that's what these super chats are, is appreciation for us doing your Orthodox homework for you. Doing the readings, knowing the books. Again, some of the books that I've recommended today, The Mystical Theology, St. Dionysius. Of course, all the secular sources are going to call him Pseudo-Dionysius. This is the complete works. I do recommend them. The complete works of Pseudo-Dionysius. Again, as Orthodox, you would say this is St. Dionysius. Earlier, I read From the Discourses by St. Simeon, the New Theologian. Definitely recommend those. Obviously, if you haven't read the Triads, get yourself some Gregory Palamas. Get yourself some Gregory Palamas. Also, if you'd like a little bit more of an overview of the mystical theology of the Eastern Church, get this book with Vladimir Lasky, of which I did a stream with Jay Dyer. So you can go check out our talk together over on his channel. And you can catch the second half over in his members only section on his website. So, those are some of the books. Thank you, Thomas Henderson, for supporting the stream, for supporting Church of the Eternal Logos. And I'm glad you guys got something out of it. There's plenty of more works. You know, there's infinite number of books within our Orthodoxy. What was the one book that, let me look real quick. This was another book that for you guys, that one of the fathers was recommending. Again, I'm not telling you to use Amazon, but The Mountain of Science. I don't have this book, but Father recommended that The Mountain of Silence, A Search for Orthodox Spirituality, is a great book on Orthodox mysticism. So I haven't read this one, but maybe this one is worth checking out. Of course, we don't want to make Bezos any more rich. Sometimes it's inevitable, but it looks like on Amazon it's only $17, which definitely more reasonable. So potentially that be a book as well for some of you guys to check out. I have not read that one, so I don't know, but I would assume based on the references, that it's a good one. So anyways, thank you all very much. Again, special shout out goes to Pano. Thank you very much, Mikhail King of Kings. And thank you, Thomas Henderson. So hope everybody enjoyed tonight's stream and got something from it. Please smash that like if you guys could. Also, if you guys would like to support Church of the Eternal Logos, again, I'll be posting a members-only video over on my website for members on the time I got arrested. Yeah. Yeah, I've been to jail, and I got a really, really fun story to share with you guys. But you're going to have to become a website member for $5 a month. You can get access to, again, you'll hear my story about getting arrested, which is quite an interesting story. You can hear my story about getting in a major fight in China. You can hear about various psychedelic experiences, my ayahuasca trips. All that stuff is over at the website for members only. And I have a few personal stories, different ones that I'm going to be uploading soon over at the website. So if you'd like to hear some of those things, a great way to help me out and become a website member. So I'd greatly appreciate that. But with that being said, hope everybody had a wonderful, blessed Sunday and enjoy it. I will be back Wednesday. I'll be busy with school stuff Monday, Tuesday. I may not stream Wednesday. I may not stream till Saturday. I don't know. I'm probably going to stream Wednesday before our theology course with Subdeacon Mark. So I should see you then. So I'll see you guys most likely Wednesday, potentially not, but most likely I'll see you guys Wednesday and Saturday. I'll stream again. So until then, as always, God bless.